So it is tea, ground staff coming on. I can see the wind whipping around Michael Holding's coattails there. He's about to do something on the boundary edge. And the sun is trying to come out, which is lovely. So during this tea interval, we're going to talk to Colin Graves. He's in his final days as chairman of the England-Wales Cricket Board after 5 years in the job. In that period, England's men and women have won the World Cup. But he's also presided over the controversial launch of the 100, which continues to divide people, and also made some headlines this week suggesting that some counties may have to become white ball only operations because of the coronavirus crisis. So somewhere on the other side of the ground, Colin Graves, good afternoon.
Hi, Jonathan. How are you?
I think I can see you standing, okay, it was a wave, sitting isolated amongst all those seats at the far end. So there we go. Well, I think, should we start with the fact that this series is on and the West Indies series and Ireland and Australia coming, I suspect. If you'd looked at the situation about 3 months ago, you must have been really fearing the worst.
Yeah, at the start of the season, Jonathan, April, May time, we were staring down the barrel and things weren't looking good at all. And then we came up with the idea of the biosecurity ground with no crowds. And our guys worked on that, and particularly Steve Elworthy, who put a plan together. And we talked with government on a regular basis to get that up and running. And it's certainly saved us from even bigger losses than what we are going to end up with. But we got international cricket back on, which was the main thing.
And are you being approached by other boards around the world as to how you've done this? And I mean, is this going to be the way forward for a while, do you think, for other countries as well?
Yeah, I think basically if you look around the world, everybody's got issues with COVID-19 and crowds. I think New Zealand are an exception over there because they've got fairly full crowds watching matches. So it's one thing I think we could possibly have to get used to for a while yet, unfortunately.
Yeah. I remember you saying when you first took on this role that you weren't expecting an easy ride. So given that you went into it thinking that, how's it turned out to be?
Well, it's been an interesting ride. I wouldn't say it's been an easy ride, but it's been interesting, it's been challenging, but at the same time I've thoroughly enjoyed it, and it's virtually taken over my life for the last 5 years. I've put my heart and soul into it, and it's been great. I've thoroughly enjoyed it, to be honest.
What have you learned about our game? And clearly you were connected with Yorkshire for a long time before taking on the whole job. But I wonder how you'd look at English cricket, the state of English cricket, the way forward for English cricket now, having had to have overall control of it.
Well, I think I keep pinching myself when I look back, because 20 years ago I was just chairman of a cricket club up in Yorkshire around York. And then I got involved with Yorkshire when they got into financial difficulties, and that was a massive learning curve of what really professional cricket was all about. Because certainly, without any shadow of a doubt, professional cricket and the cricket business is just, it's not like a normal business. There's so much history with the game, there's so much passion about the game, and virtually, when I came in, I remember my dear friend Jeffrey, who turned around and said, you know, what's this supermarket whiz kid going to come and do and help sort out Yorkshire? But at the end of the day, we did sort it out, and we turned it round, and we've got Yorkshire in a good place. And that's basically because we had to run it like a business. Sport's important, the cricket's important, but you've got to be profitable, and if you're not profitable, you don't stay long anyway.
No. What needs to change? I mean, okay, I'll go back a step. Would there have change been necessary in our game, like now, with or without coronavirus? I mean, do you think that it's inevitable that the English game does have to change in order to survive?
I think coronavirus will concentrate minds. You know, we did the broadcasting deal, which the new broadcasting deal came in this year, 2020, for 5 years, and you know, we had a very good budget to spread and spend across the game, recreational cricket, women's cricket, schools cricket, etc. You know, that's now changed going forward because we won't have the money that we anticipated. So I think it is a time for the game to just stop and reflect, and it's what I said to the chairman when I spoke to him for the last time last week, was now's the time where really you need to sit down together, you need to sit down with the ECB and all the other stakeholders and look at what we've got and just see if there's an opportunity to look at remodelling what we've got, because it's like a lot of things, you know, you go along and you keep investing in things year after year after year, but when something changes dramatically like COVID-19 has done to us, it's changed the world, it's changed lives, it's changed businesses, you know, cricket, I believe, has got an opportunity just to stop and look at what we've got and what we can have going forward. Can we do it better? Can we do it differently? And that's the message that I've just left English cricket with, because I think there's an opportunity just to consult about it and talk about it and look at it, rather than just turn around and say, well, we all want to go back to where we were.
I imagine that remodelling is an easier pill to swallow than closing down or reducing the number of counties or something. I mean, do you still see a future for the 18 counties, but albeit, well, remodelled, as you said?
Yeah, I've always said this, Jonathan. Again, it annoyed me when I first took over that people were saying I was anti-18 counties. I have never, ever been anti-18 counties, and I never will be. What I've said is there is a role for 18 counties, and there may be different roles for 18 counties, and it may be a different model that counties play under. And that's all I'm leaving the game with, is a message to look at the models that are available and could be available, because can we do it better? We've got an opportunity now to just take stock of where we are and just let's look at it, let's talk about it. We know roughly where we're going to be financial-wise, hopefully, at the end of September. The only thing which we don't know about is whether crowds are going to be here next year, or 50% crowds or 30% crowds. That's the unknown factor at the present time. But at the end of the day, just let's talk about it.
If you were leading the remodelling, rather than leaving the remodelling, if you were leading it, what would you like to do? Where would you like to see it going? How would you see? I mean, you talked about some counties only playing white ball cricket, so they'd be involved in the blast or the 50 overs or whatever. But you really think that there is a future for counties to give up their first class status?
I wouldn't say that they give up the first class status, Jonathan. Again, people, you know, put different slants on things that I've said over the years, so I've got to be careful what I say, but I can say it now.
Because you can say it on the record.
Because I'm leaving the ECB, so yes. It's not down to me going forward. But I think there is something to look at where basically, and people have said this to me on a regular basis over the last 5 years, the standard of the second division at the bottom is not very good. That we're playing a lot of average cricket down there. A lot of the matches don't last 4 days. Personally, and this is me, so don't anybody take it as an ECB proposition going forward. It is not. My personal choice would be to look at 3 divisions of 6 or 3 divisions of 7. You could introduce 3 new teams into that bottom division, and virtually I would have the top 2, first and second division, as 4-day cricket, so you'd have 12 or 14 teams playing in the top 2 divisions, and the third division I would have playing 3-day red ball cricket but semi-pro, and it'd still be first class cricket, but it'd be a different slant to 1 and 2 divisions. And that's my take on it.
That's interesting.
That's what I would look at, to say, just let's take stock and how can we make it better. And if you're playing semi-pro in the third division, 3 days, I think you'll get a slant of people coming to play in that who are still working and want to break into cricket. It'll give them an opportunity to break into it. And it's taking nothing away from those counties. It's just saying, can you play a third division, better standard and better intensity, really?
Yeah. I suspect there's probably somewhere where you might feel you've also been misquoted or misunderstood, so we might want to clear up, is the question of the 100. And how it came to be, really. I mean, there's been so many rumours and things about how is 100 actually came to exist, or at least the concept of it hasn't actually happened yet. But what was the background? Now you're going. You can say what was the background to this tournament, and why do you feel that you needed it?
Yeah, the big thing, and we've said this all the way down the line, but a lot of people tend to forget why we looked at the 100, and we did a lot of research into the 100. We didn't do it on the back of a fact packet and somebody getting up one morning and Sanjay Patel saying, "Oh, this is a good idea," and he talked to Andrew Strauss, and Strauss said, "Yeah, I'll go along with that," etc. A lot of people looked at what we were doing, and they looked at the audience that we were having and the support that we're having. And when it boiled down to it, we have constantly about a million people each year who turn up and watch cricket. That's right across Test cricket, T20, the whole shooting match. So we had about a standard million people. And that was stagnant. It wasn't moving anywhere, really. And yet we've got 10 million people who follow cricket. So there's a massive gap of 9 million people who never came and watched. So we then looked at something to attract a new audience, and that new audience is women, children, families, a bit of an entertainment product, a shorter game, because in all the research that came out was cricket's too complicated, it goes on too long, we can't understand it, and that's why we don't come. So we looked at a model of what could attract that new audience into cricket, and the 100 ticked all those boxes. And we have worked tirelessly for the last 2.5 years, and it's a pity this year we had to postpone it. It was the right decision to postpone it, don't get me wrong.
Yes.
But basically, we've worked for 2.5 years to get this model right for the 100. And the 100 board, who's worked tirelessly with our executive to build that and get that ready, it will be different. It will be a different form of entertainment. Yes, it's cricket. It's a shorter form cricket. It'll be 2.5 hours. And we want to attract that new audience, and that's what people forget. We don't want to turn the existing cricket audience away. That's the last thing we want. We want them to come as well as the new audience.
Yeah. Do you regret some of the PR at the time, when I guess you were defensive of the 100, but the message seemed very much to be that it was not for existing cricket followers, it was for an entirely new audience? And I think that certainly put the noses out of joint of a lot of people who love the game.
Yeah, it did, and I think there was one or two mischievous people who put that out. We didn't put that ourselves out categorically, just as you said it. One problem we had, and this is a problem that the game has got, if we need to change anything within the game, within the constitution, within the formats, etc., we have to consult with our stakeholders, rightfully so. Nothing wrong with that at all. So we consulted with our stakeholders for a year, 18 months, and then we had to go to a vote to change the constitution to get the new game accepted by the game. During all that consultation, there was a lot of mischief put out there by various people, by various journalists, by various stakeholders, who virtually tried to undermine it for various reasons that they thought fit. That didn't help us at all, and it made it 100 times difficult to do it. But when it came to the vote, and I remind people of this, when it came to the vote for the 100, we've got 41 stakeholders, it was 38-3. Now that to me is unanimous.
It's almost, yes, certainly. Can you afford it? I mean, we've talked about the cutbacks going to happen.
Of course we can afford it.
You could afford it next year?
Yes, we can, because basically another thing that a lot of people don't realise is that the new broadcasting deal, including the 100, brought BBC, terrestrial television, back into the frame, back onto the negotiating table, and the 100 is going to be on BBC terrestrial television as well as Sky. So from that perspective, that new money coming in substantially then allowed us to give the professional stakeholders 1.3 million each guaranteed. So if the 100's not here next year, each county will be 1.3 million down on what they're anticipating. That is fact.
That is if you don't receive the money from the broadcasters, but you haven't had that this year.
Well, we haven't had it this year because we haven't played it.
No, exactly.
So if we decide, and not we, I can't say we anymore,
no.
But if ECB decide next year, if we've still got this COVID-19 and we're still playing behind closed doors, and they decide to play the 100 behind closed doors, then the broadcasting money will still come in because we're still playing it.
Do you think it would work behind closed doors, given that the whole idea of this
is to
get people in and to be entertainment, as you said, to try and imagine launching a new tournament of this type with no one there would be a real challenge, wouldn't it?
It would be a challenge, but at the end of the day, what we have talked about, and we had a 100 board meeting last week, and that 100 board was very positive that if we cannot have crowds next year, they believe that we should go ahead with the tournament and create it as an entertainment product. We've seen it on television this year with no crowds, and I saw the viewing figures yesterday for the first time, and the viewing figures both on Sky and BBC highlights and everything for cricket are fantastic. They have gone through the roof.
Yes.
So to me, if that's happened this year and that's all been done in a short space of time, if we have to play behind closed doors next year, let's make it an entertainment product to get these viewers and to get these new audience watching the new 100 game.
Can you see yourself being able to sell it elsewhere? I mean, to give it a much wider context, if you like. I mean, do you have other countries who have shown interest in it?
I can tell you now, Jonathan, and I've sat on the ICC board for the last 3 years, and I can tell you now, there are countries around the world who are looking at what we're doing, very interested in what we're doing, and from that perspective, I think we've got a massive opportunity with the 100. The 100 is a big asset to the ECB. It's brand new, it's ours, we own it. If we handle that properly and get it off the ground, which we will do, I'm pretty sure that's going to happen, we have got a valuable asset that we can take around the world, because I think it's exciting.
Quick change of subject, because the umpires are coming out any moment now. How much of a blow to the women's game do you think it has been that there is, it looks as if it's unlikely there'll be any women's internationals this summer?
Well, it's disappointing, certainly, and it's unfortunate that South Africa and India couldn't travel over here. You know, we are talking at the present time to West Indies, and hopefully we might be able to get the West Indies women over here for some international cricket, so we're still working on that one. And this is what the exec team's been doing ever since COVID-19 started, and that's why we've been able to secure international cricket with Pakistan, with West Indies, Australia, and Ireland. You know, to achieve that has been phenomenal behind closed doors.
Yes.
And we're hoping to get some women's cricket, not as much as we anticipated, at the back end of September-ish.
Meanwhile, are you sailing off to the ICC, Colin?
Well, again, Jonathan, that's not up to me. The way the ICC elections work is, firstly, you have to be nominated by a board member of the ICC, and you can't nominate yourself. So if I don't get nominated, then my hat doesn't go in the ring.
Do you want to do it?
What I've said to everybody is, if I do get nominated, I will then look at it and see if I want to pursue that route. There's a big job to do there. There's a lot of work to do within ICC. So yes, it's a challenge. I always like a challenge. It's never bothered me, as you know. But we'll wait and see.
Okay. Highlight of your 5 years. Go on. Let me give you. You can indulge yourself for 20 seconds, Colin. What was the time you stood there and said, "My word, that's the best part of this."
There was two mainly, winning the Men's World Cup and winning the Women's World Cup. To me, it were fantastic days. It was better still because it was on home soil at Lord's. So those two achievements were absolutely fantastic. And I'll never forget those, and I've been proud to be part of the ECB for 5 years.
Thank you, Colin. Thank you for your company over the last 5 years, and good luck with, if you decide whether to run for the ICC job or not. But thanks for joining us today.
Thanks, John.